Many gals be all the night. Jack, she's mighty slick, and she really knocks me out, but she's my brother's chick.
Hello and welcome to the Matt Dillahunty After Party. Thank you guys for joining in. If you saw the last show, we had a really good conversation with Matt about a number of different topics and how he feels about it. I was extremely excited to have him on, and I'm sure you guys were happy to see him come on too. He is joining us for the After Party. We also have a few others that are joining us also. We have Bryce with us. We also have Greg, who is a Christian, who's coming on to have a conversation with us. We got Christian Watkins, who has his own channel. Go and check him out. Show him some love. And we also have James Gibson, who was also a co-host on the show earlier. We will be popping people in and out periodically, pretty quickly, actually. So if you guys have any questions in the chat, I'll try and take some of them down. The people who are on the panel will just spend, you know, maybe about 10 minutes a person to just go through and have a conversation with Matt. As long as you'd like to hang out, Matt. Normally these last, we try and cut it off at about an hour and a half. So if you got to leave before then, that's totally cool. But that's typically how long we run the after show.
I just like the fact that, like, in all the time that I've had discussions as an atheist with Christians, mm-hmm. Greg is the first one who is running before we even spoke. I was outstanding. Greg's just out there just running.
I'm running. I was had gone to a volleyball match at our local school, and unfortunately my wife was there. She needed to stay, and my cell phone was running out of gas. So I'm running back home actually to plug it in. So, but I'll be fine. I'll be fine. If I keel over, y'all think good thoughts for me.
Thoughts so. Will definitely be in there for you.
Thank you.
And at least one person in here will actually pray for you.
Thank you. I appreciate it. Thanks, James.
I didn't say who it was.
I just outed you, James.
You're correct. Yeah, you are correct.
It's the only real Christian in the room.
So, well.
Except
for me.
It's okay.
She's learning her alphabet.
Awesome. Can you do it backwards? ZYXWVUTSRQPONMLKJIHGUVA. That takes some practice.
It does. I don't know.
Can you do the phonetic alphabet backwards?
What? No, I can barely do it forward anymore. I've forgotten so much.
So Greg, did you have any questions or anything that you'd like to bring up?
You know, I do. Because as you guys know, I kind of approach this thing a little bit differently sometimes than other Christians. I guess the question I have for you is, what would you do with the God of the Bible, or what would you do with the Bible if for some reason it had things like evolution and it said, yes, that's part of the way that I created things? And, you know, some of the other things that you look at and say, hey, wait, this is a naturalistic way that God did this, or that this stuff could happen without God. What if the Bible said that's the way it happened, and it did so before mankind ever came up with that as being even a possible solution? Yeah. If it said that was the solution, what would you think at that point?
I think that was very interesting. It would certainly give more credence to the claims. However, if the fact that the Bible gets a lot of things right,
yeah.
But there are some things that, even if it got right, nobody was justified in believing them until we discovered them independently. And until then, it's like a hypothesis. Somebody it thinks this is the way it works, and then we test it. If the Bible, you know, described things as you suggested, Greg, it would be, I'd have a different take on it. It would certainly be presenting a better case. Yeah. But I think the most I could say is that it would be less wrong. And
okay. And
if it were less wrong, that's good. But if we reach a point where someone is convinced that what the Bible has to say, whether they look at the Bible now or your fictional version of what it could say, and they're convinced that this is clearly sufficient evidence to show that God exists.
Yeah.
Now we're in a scenario, and I believe that, and I'm not going to speak for you guys, but I believe most of the Christians that I've ever met believe that we have sufficient evidence so that any reasonable person should conclude that a God exists. And for the Christians who think that, they have to then answer, if it's so obvious, why is God still hiding?
Right.
But if the Bible said more accurate things, then yeah, I'd have to take it slightly more seriously, but we still wouldn't be in a position to know.
Yeah, because I think one of the things that I presented to these gentlemen is, and I'm not saying that evolution is true, I'm just saying, hey, here's a literal interpretation of the Bible where it could actually be saying it. I mean, if you notice in the first chapter of Genesis, every time the Bible refers to God creating something that's inanimate, he says, let there be and there is. But when he creates something that's alive, he says, let the earth bring forth, let the water teem, let the sky. So he speaks to the natural and commands it to do something. Now, right. I know it's a weak step. It's not a strong statement about evolution, but in a book that's not really geared towards talking to us about creation and teaching us everything about it, it could be that he's alluding to it and saying, hey, look,
yeah,
I started something.
I'm agreeing with you that would be very interesting. The problem is he didn't even bother to make sure that the order of events in Genesis 1 is correct. The order of events in Genesis 1 is flat wrong. And so if God's trying to allude to this, you'd think he wouldn't make such big mistakes, you know, where you have the earth before the sun and the stars, where you have, you know, things that require light and water and different. I'd have to look up exactly what the order is, and we've talked about it before. But the order is clearly wrong. And so you could make the case that God is sitting here saying, eventually people are going to figure out the natural methods that I used to make this happen.
Yes.
But if you make that case and we're now at that point, then God should stop hiding and everybody should be justified in thinking, why was God hiding all this time and put this out here? It still doesn't make sense to me. It's like God wants you to know something, but wants you to find it out on your own. Well, cool. Then why point to it at all? And by the way, even when we found it out, like when we discovered, you know, evolution, and Catholics have no problem at all with evolution. Even if the Bible said, here's how God did it. It wasn't until we actually tested and confirmed, hey, all life shares a common ancestry. And then we extrapolate from that. It's like the information didn't provide us anything useful, and then was surrounded by a bunch of crap. Like, wash your hands is a really good idea. It's like a precursor to understanding the germ theory of disease. And so if somebody can, you know, point to somewhere in the Bible and say, hey, look, the Bible says wash your hands. This is clearly what this is for, was to teach us about the germ theory of disease. But then you point to another verse in the Bible. Oh, we lost Greg.
We did.
I'm sorry.
Yeah, he may still be listening, but I think he said his phone.
Yeah, he can come back and listen to it afterwards. The final point that I was going to make is that, you know, the Bible also lists a cure for leprosy, which is absolute black blood magic batshittery that just doesn't work. So,
you're on.
Hey. Oh, I am. Awesome.
What's up?
Hello, hello, Matt.
Hey.
I'm sorry, I'm just stealing the floor here. I'm Jimmy Liu. I have to say, I am just, I know we don't like the word fan, but just such a respect for you. And even my wife would thank you, because I came out of 20 years worth of indoctrination, and it was actually finding AXP in your arguments. And of course, my wife and all friends and all these little seeds that were planted, but you really, your arguments really set me free. It literally set me free. And it's what compels me to use the same arguments as you present and others that are more smarter than me to help other people get over the fear of hell, because it's such a huge issue right now. I hear so many people on your show call up about this fear of hell. Even atheists are still worried about that. So I thank you so much. Thank you so much.
Well, you're welcome. I'm glad it was useful. I appreciate you saying so. Thanks.
Absolutely. I would have saw you in Toronto. I live in Canada. So I would have saw you in Toronto, but my son had a basketball tournament that day, and I was so disappointed. But
well, if you didn't buy tickets early, you would not have seen me in Toronto, because that was the Jordan Peterson event, and that was way sold out.
Oh, I know. I know. My friend went and saw it, but he lives in Toronto, but I never got the chance to. But yeah, it was good. I think I saw some of the recaps of your conversation with him, and it was really good. So. And thank you for taking, like, I love Justin. I love all the guys here, and you've done just such a, this is such an amazing bump for all of them. And how is that? I watched your show. Your new show is great.
Thank you.
You can speak your mind on so many more issues now.
Thank you. I'm enjoying it.
Yeah, Christian, you said you had to go here soon. If you wanted to go ahead and get your questions in here and get that so we can get somebody else in here also.
Yeah, sure. I didn't want to step on any toes. Thanks again, Matt, for coming on the Empathetic Atheist Show. I'm usually on these after parties a bunch, so it's really awesome to talk to you. I had a couple.
This better be a really good question, or I'm going to ban you from my Twitch stream.
Well, I'm gonna start with a more interesting stream related question, and then I have a question I've wanted to ask for a while. So, you talk occasionally about when you used to run the number one Counter-Strike team in the nation, and. Yes. As if you hadn't talked about this enough on stream, I wanted to introduce this topic to a different YouTube audience. So could you give first the background to how that came about, and then tell my favorite story, which is the planning on actual physical maps and not doing any sort of external cheating, and just actually, you know, getting into the game and planning out maps wise over coffee. Just tell, I love that story. I'd like to hear that story.
Okay. I'll try to do this quickly for anybody. So I am a longtime old school gamer for as long as there have been games and various consoles and the PC as well. I was at QuakeCon 97 competing along, you know, sitting next to Romero and Kill Creek and competing alongside a bunch of other people, and was big into first person shooters. And so we did Half-Life Deathmatch, Team Fortress, all that stuff. And then when Counter-Strike came out, myself and two of my roommates would get together, just the three of us, and we would go jump onto servers and take out entire clans. They were clans then. I think they've changed the names to teams or whatever else. But so we became CK3, which was Clan Killers 3. And we would just run around, and we'd get banned from servers. You know, oh, you guys must be cheating, because Dunning-Kruger is overwhelming in gamers. They think if they're the best person that's on their server, now all of a sudden they think they're the best person in the world, when in truth, you're probably still a scrub. But we dominated in all of the online leagues. We fielded three different teams for some of the first CPL events. But the key difference between our team and some of the others, while most of us were coming from a first-person shooter background, and so we had our Twitch-based aim and shoot skills, I would not have been able to compete against like Thresh and others who were really just top of the line. And yet we ran the number one Counter-Strike team. And the reason for that was twofold. One, we had a zero lag communication system. We used phones and would dial into a service. And nobody on our team was ever allowed to do Ghost Recon. When you were dead, you shut up. And the reason that that was not only the right thing to do, because it's not cheating, it was actually better. Because what we would do is go into single player, zoom out so you could get an overhead view of the map, print out the entire map, then laminate that map. And we did this for all of them, Dust2, Train, everything. Laminate the entire map, and then our team, which was entirely based in Austin, or almost entirely based in Austin, would go out for lunch. We would sit at a huge table, and we would pull up a map, and we would outline different strategies for both terrorists and counter-terrorists, and give them names. And then everybody knew when the round started, you know, the team leader for that round would be like, okay, it's a save round, if we were going to save money. Or they'd say, you know, okay, we're doing alpha. And everybody knew exactly where to go, and they knew where everybody else was, which means if you died and Counter-Strike, it'll pop up here, you know, K-Sharp was killed with an AWP, so you know it was a sniper by this person on the other team. And I know where that where my teammate was. I don't need them to tell me that they're dead. I already saw that. I don't need them to tell me that they were sniped. I saw that. I don't need them to tell me where they saw the enemy, because if I understand the map and I know where that person died, I now know exactly where that enemy is. And then the team leader can call for people to, you know, shift to A, shift to B, various bomb points and things like that. So we didn't ever have to cheat. And yet every person we ever recruited from another team, without fail, tried to cheat at least once. They would talk after they're dead. Ghost Recon, you don't need it if you're working as a team. That's why we were so strong. It wasn't that we were the best, you know, we weren't Thresh level of just deathmatch. We worked as a proper team. There was strategy, it was calling out, and we clobbered everybody because everybody else was still thinking in terms of deathmatch. Nobody was really thinking. CK3, and when I retired, the team went on to be X3, as in XCK3, and then those guys went on to be 3D, and that would be K-Sharp, Bullseye, Rambo, all of these guys. We invented proper team play within Counter-Strike for the world, and then I went on to play MMOs and other stuff. So there's your story.
Yeah. So the reason why I asked that kind of precursor question wasn't just to hear you talk about your Counter-Strike days. It was actually to draw a parallel between how you prepare for debates and how much that is influenced by some of the previous endeavors you've done. So is there parallels, you think, between that kind of intense, very procedural preparation that you would do for games like Counter-Strike compared to how you would prepare for debates, laying out the conversation, trying to pick apart specific strategies and in particular argumentation styles? Does that carry over to your debate preparation nowadays?
Yes, but it also comes from one other thing, which is I've been a magician since I was 3. And that's when I got my first magic kit. I wasn't really properly a serious magician until I was about 11 or 12. But one of the things with a lot of the way magic shows and magicians will work is you prepare for everything that could possibly go wrong. What happens if I drop this? What happens if this happens? What happens if somebody, a member of the audience, says this? What if this gets seen? If you go through and you prepare for everything that you can think of that could go wrong, and then every time you do the effect, every time you discover something new goes wrong, now you're prepared for that. You're not going to be surprised and everything's going to go better. And you're going to be able to hide mistakes as well. That those things together help to get to the debate prep. Like I've done debates where I did 30 minutes of actual pre-debate prep with notebook and paper, only because I've done 15 years of prep to lead up to that moment. And it's the 15 years that was the important part. The 30 minutes wasn't.
All right. Well, those are the two kind of the combination question I had. Thanks again, Matt, for coming on. I appreciate it. I'm going to step out so I can give some other people a chance.
Yeah, it's long answers, and I'm known for long answers. I'm going to try to be a little bit more succinct. Thanks.
I can ask my question real quick so that I can pop out and make room for somebody else as well. Matt, I know that you are not a scientist, but I know you've heard this argument presented quite often, so I won't like represent it, but what are your thoughts on the cosmological argument? And I know it's also been classically called the cosmological argument.
Mm-hmm. Cosmological arguments are an entire category of arguments, but the Kalam famously, for me, it cannot possibly be an argument for the existence of God, because the word God, the term God, and the concept God appear nowhere in the Kalam. The entirety of the Kalam is everything that begins to exist has a cause for its existence. The universe began to exist. Therefore, the universe has a cause for its existence. That is both premises and the conclusion of the Kalam. Everything else that gets from that conclusion to a God is something else that is being added to the Kalam. So A, God's not a part of the Kalam. You have to add something to it to get there. B, I don't know that premise one is necessarily true, although it may feel like that. I don't know how you demonstrate it. And premise two is also potentially questionable as to whether or not the universe had a beginning, because that gets to definitions. Because maybe the cosmos had no beginning, but our local presentation of the universe did, in which case it would still have a cause for it, but we know nothing about the cause. And the Kalam doesn't tell you anything about the cause either. So...
I was actually speaking on this earlier today with some people.
Thank you again for your thoughts. There's my toy collection.
Yay! Oh, there's foley. Wow, you've got lots of foleys.
I've got the mask, too, as well. Wow. You can see that. But thanks again, guys.
Thanks, James. Appreciate it.
Take care, bud.
You were saying something, Justin?
Yeah, I was actually having a discussion about the Kalam today. And I was actually speaking to a group of Muslim friends of mine that I speak to just about every day. And the question, you know, that I posed to them is that, would you be able to show me something that, that had a beginning, that, you know, premise one is everything that begins to exist has a cause. And if we look at the first law of thermodynamics, matter and energy cannot be created nor destroyed. So within our local representation of the universe, everything like this cup right here, yes, you could say that the cup itself, the concept of the cup, you know, within the English language, started to exist at one point in time. But before this cup was a cup, it was just a, matter and energy, you know, spread apart the universe. So technically the cup within a physical form has never began to exist. The conglomeration of it just put together is a cup. So that's why I would refute or reject the first premise of the Kalam cosmological argument before we even get to talking about how we don't know, you know, the cause of the universe.
Yeah, I have a question.
Well, let me get mine in here really quick because I'm going to go so that Justin can pop in more people. But
I'll save time. I'll save time here. Bryce, I agree with you. No,
well,
go for
I don't
it.
Know.
Don't say that.
This is actually a question, and I'm looking to see if I'm right or wrong on this one. Oftentimes we have morality discussions. And the topic of Abraham comes up either by me intentionally bringing it up as an example of someone who was called righteous, but in my opinion, did a demonstrably unrighteous thing or attempted to. And I'll invariably make an analogy between him and Andrea Yates, who famously drowned her children, unfortunately, believing that they would go straight to heaven, etc. Andrea Yates presumably would have been someone who believed in God, heard God speaking to her. The story of Abraham in the Old Testament is presented as him hearing the voice of God telling him to sacrifice Isaac. Is there something wrong with me making that particular analogy? Because the biggest Christian objection that I can think of is the fact that, one, Andrea Yates is not in the Bible, and Abraham is. And two, Andrea Yates did what she did in a time after Jesus came, and Abraham was before that, which to me I dismiss as non-convincing for a variety of reasons. But are there any other objections to that particular analogy? I don't see the difference between Andrea Yates and Abraham. And yet, almost every Christian would immediately recognize her as being, they would call her evil. I wouldn't. I would call her mentally unbalanced, but they would probably call her evil. And yet Abraham is called righteous. So is that an unfair analogy?
No. So I don't. So first of all, I did a video specifically about the Binding of Isaac, the story, not the game that I play on Twitch. But, and I don't know if you've seen that, but I don't want to rehash the whole thing, but I'll say this. As a Christian, my understanding of the story of Abraham and Isaac is that God was testing Abraham. Now, clearly, God is not testing Abraham for God's benefit because God already knows what's going to happen. So the test must be something for Abraham's benefit. And it is to let Abraham know that, okay, you're doing what God wants, or et cetera. However, what actually happens in the story is, if it were to happen, and Abraham is a righteous man, and God's representative comes in and says, Abraham, I want you to kill your firstborn son, Isaac. And Abraham does all of the things that are required, gathers up his son, everything else, goes off and goes up to kill him. That means in Abraham's head, it is perfectly reasonable and acceptable and consistent with the character of God that God would ask him to kill his son. Which means, and when he went to do it, and God rewarded him for that, God is now rewarding Abraham for having an internal concept of God that is consistent with God demanding you kill your child, which means that God must be okay with killing your child. Otherwise, you don't reward that. So this entire test, if God is actually opposed to infanticide, if God is actually opposed to child sacrifice, then when God comes to Abraham and says, I want you to kill your child, Abraham's one and only correct answer was, depart from me, I don't know who you are, but the true living God would never ask me to kill my child, because that's the only right answer. And when God rewards what modern Christians view as the wrong answer, then God is misrepresenting things in Abraham's mind. Okay. So this entire story is awful. And what it does is it shows that God rewarded Abraham for thinking that God wanted him to kill his kid, that that was consistent with God, which means God mustn't necessarily be in favor of child sacrifice, which, by the way, is consistent with other things in the Bible as well, other passages of, you know, let's kill and eat your children and things like that. But
I actually thought you were going to find a way to disagree with me about some, because I was convinced that there was some flaw in my analogy, but that's the conclusion I've arrived at as well. And so I will wait to see if someone can find another flaw. I'm going to keep using the analogy until someone presents it as flawed in a way that's reasonable to me. But I appreciate you taking my question. Sure. I appreciate you coming on the show. And I'm going to take off to let some other people have an opportunity to have a discussion with you. So thanks a lot.
Great. Thanks, Bryce.
Thanks, Bryce.
Hey, I've got a question, if I can jump in.
Sure. What's up, Johnny?
Hey, Justin. Thanks for having me on the after party. Matt Dillahunty, I've never talked with you on your show. I've listened to a few excerpts from your show off of YouTube and whatnot. So it's actually my pleasure to be speaking with a man of your intellect.
Oh, well. I'll disappoint you here in a second, but thank you.
No, you're doing fine. However, I just want to say, starting off, I mean, it's obviously clear to me that you're a sinner, because when I listened to the show, you were talking about, you committed a sin. You were talking about wrestling, and you did not mention Ric Flair. That is a sin. I'm sorry. How do you mention wrestling and not talk about Ric Flair? So obviously you're a sinner. That's very clear to me. Yeah, there you go.
I got a picture of me with Arn, if that'll make up for it.
That's not good enough. That's not good enough. But nonetheless, I think James Gibson, I think he's actually met Ric Flair. But aside from all that, I've got two quick things. Number one, when you used to be a believer, when you were a believer, did you proselytize to atheists? Did you make sort of an apologetics argument to atheists? And if you did, what was it?
Yeah, so when I was a teenager and active, well, I was active in the church all the way up until I was 18, 19, and then I went in the Navy. We would go out for Monday night visitation. Basically, if you showed up at church and you filled out the little card, we would then go and visit. At the time, I didn't realize that I was potentially going and talking to atheists. The word atheist didn't even really exist for me, apart from, I remember watching, staying home one day, and I watched Phil Donahue, and Madeline Murray O'Hare was on there. I had no idea who she was or what was going on, but my mom heard it on the TV and came in from the kitchen and turned it off and told me how she was an evil atheist and all this. That's the only time I heard the word. But I witnessed to plenty of non-believers. I witnessed to plenty of non-Christians, because in my head, these are people who just, like, intuitively, like everybody else, knew there was a God. They just hadn't found Jesus yet. And it's not my job as a believer to lead somebody to Christ. That's the Holy Spirit working through me. And so the only thing that I could do was to give them my personal testimony. And I always felt that my personal testimony was pretty weak, because I walked down an aisle at the age of five. I was raised, or, you know, I was around, you know, Southern Baptist my entire life. I got saved and that was it. I was just involved. It's not like I came through any hardships. I didn't feel like I had a particularly good testimony. And so mostly on those rare occasions when I would witness to others, it would be telling them what I understood about God. And that was constantly changing, because as a teenager, I would learn something in church and then say, well, I couldn't have understood this when I was five. So there's no way I was really saved when I was five. I better get saved now. And then I would do something, you know, not have a perfect walk with Christ. So the entire teen years of mine was this cycle of either getting saved because it didn't happen right the first time, or rededicating my life over and over again. It was this guilt cycle of you can't live up to what God wants, and so you've got to keep asking for forgiveness. So on the rare occasions when I would witness to people who didn't share my beliefs and didn't go to church, I had no concept that I might be talking to a proper atheist, because that just, it never came up. And all I would do would share, here's my thoughts on Jesus, here's how Jesus saved me, but I didn't feel like I had a particularly good witness. It was mostly about getting them the introduction so they could come into church and listen to the preacher, who knew way more about this than I did. So hopefully that's
right.
Close.
Yeah, no, no, I hear you. I think you mentioned earlier, and I've heard Dawkins talk about it. He did a CNN chair interview once, and I think they asked him the question of, okay, you know, if you, you know, after you die and you found yourself standing before God, what type of questions would you ask? And, you know, then he stated, after he goes into asking a litany of questions about, okay, who are you? Are you Baal? Are you Dagon? Are you the God of the Bible? Blah, blah, blah. After he went through that, then he asked, he said, why did you take great pains to hide yourself? And I think you mentioned something about that earlier, about God hiding himself. I've said this before. In a sense, based on my theology, based on my understanding of Christianity, in a sense, God is actually doing that on purpose. Now, I want to sort of explain that for a second.
For clarity, Johnny, you're saying that, so the argument from divine hiddenness is one of my favorites. What you're suggesting is that there is a God who is actively hiding himself.
In a sense. Now, when I say in a sense, now, of course, you know, if you're just going to look at the Bible, you look at Romans 1:20, it says, you know, based on the things that have been created, man is without excuse. Well, that doesn't necessarily mean man is without excuse because he does not believe that Jesus Christ was risen from the dead, or he's without excuse because he's not a Christian. I look at Romans 1:20 in a basic sense of seeing the world around us and seeing that it reflects having been created. But that is vague in terms of, I cannot look at a tree and tell who God is per se. I think that's, Romans 1:20 is sort of a basic reflection of the universe, but that does not get you to the God of Christianity per se. Although it's in the Bible, of course, but it's more vague. In other words, knowing who, the Bible does not tell you, it's not a manual of, here's step by step on how to believe the universe was created. The Bible is actually purported and promoted as, this is who God is. So what I'm saying is, the Romans 1:20 is kind of a basic, but that doesn't get you to know who God is. And in that context of saying that God is, in a sense, purposely hiding himself, I actually agree with that. And this is why it is always strange for me. Mm-hmm. And I've talked with atheists over the years in a lot of these debates and chats, and et cetera. And it's always strange to me when an atheist will interact with a Christian and say, well, hey, look, you know, prove to me that that the God of the Bible is real. Prove to me. Show me something. Give me something testable and some sort of prove something that I can see that you're saying that you see. You talked earlier about having faith in the chair that you're sitting in, and you can transfer that type of faith by, you know, I can observe the same chair that you're observing. I can then test the same chair by sitting in it myself. So in other words, what you have, I guess you could call faith and trust in that chair holding you up, that can be transferred to other people. But according to Scripture, you know, the one who has the Holy Spirit, purportedly anyway, that cannot be transferred. So when an atheist asks a Christian, prove to me that, you know, this God you're speaking of is real, and I realize that, you know, we can argue about proof. Proof exists in logic and mathematics, actually not in science, but nonetheless, I understand what I'm not trying to be picayune. I understand what the atheist is requesting. But it sort of strikes me funny, as if when I see Christians jump into that response as if to think, okay, an atheist just challenged me to prove God. I'm going to take a stab at it, and I'm going to somehow try to transfer this Holy Spirit in a way that this other person can see what I see. But if you read the Bible, of course, it talks about, you know, no one comes to the Father unless the Father draws them. It cannot be transferred.
But you're,
I cannot share. I'm not looking for that experience with someone else.
I'm not looking for a transfer. I'm looking for Christians to do what they're instructed to do under 1 Peter 3:15. And that's why when you say you're confused that Christians do this, when they're like, when an atheist comes up and says, demonstrate, you know, why it is reasonable to believe in a God, which is all I'm ever doing. Right. Please demonstrate. Tell me what you believe and why you believe it. And the why is the most important part, because if you tell me you believe it just because, and it's something you can't demonstrate, then okay, we have nothing to talk about. But under 1 Peter 3:15, you're commanded to be prepared at all times to give the reason for the faith that you have. And that's why
correct.
I run around to Christians saying, okay, demonstrate why this is reasonable. And in the entire history of the world, nobody's done that. And now you're pointing at Romans 1:20, which, by the way, Romans 1:20 basically says, hey, dumbass, it's obvious. Just look around. There's a God. That's all Romans 1:20 says. And so when I look around, I don't see that it's obvious at all. And neither does the overwhelming majority of people who have a scientific understanding of the world.
Well, that's fine. But even with 1 Peter is talking about, you know, if someone asks, if you explain to them the reason that you have hope in Jesus Christ, well, that doesn't necessarily mean even that explanation is then going to be convincing. But what I'm saying is...
Hang on, Johnny. Do you think that the Bible is inspired by God?
Yes.
Okay. And so God has inspired a passage that instructs you to be prepared to give the reason, and the word there in Greek is logos.
Yes.
Now, I understand that some Christians can just say, that just means I need to tell you about Jesus, because Jesus is the word and Jesus is logos. But do you think that God would tell you to provide a reason and then not care whether or not it's convincing? Because that's what you just said, is that you can provide a reason, but it's not going to be convincing. Is God just punking you?
Well, but Matt, if you're going to follow the story of Jesus Christ, even when Jesus Christ, according to Scripture, even when Jesus Christ walked the earth and performed miracles, Scripture even teaches that even then people saw and did not believe. So what I'm saying is, this goes back to what I'm talking about, the hiddenness. Now, some people would call me a Calvinist. I've never really identified as such, but some people say, hey, Johnny, based on what you believe, you're actually a Calvinist. Okay, well, fine. Define that if you like. But what I'm saying is the person cannot know God unless God reveals himself to that person. So, you know, even in Jesus's time, they saw and still didn't believe.
So can I ask this, Johnny? Ask this, Johnny?
Yes.
If God chooses who he will and won't reveal himself to, and I honestly, sincerely seek God, and God chooses to never reveal himself to me, how can that be my fault?
Well, I mean, you got to look at it based on what God would consider, a sinful person, meaning that if you stood before God on judgment day and God asks in regards to sin, Matt, are you guilty? What are you going to say?
That is not remotely in the ballpark of an answer to my question.
Yes, it is. You're talking about
No, it's false. Not. I asked you, if God chooses not to reveal himself to me, how can that possibly be my fault?
As a sinner?
How can it be my fault that I do not believe in a God who intentionally hides from me and will not reveal himself to me?
Well, as Romans 1:20 is concerned, it teaches that you're without excuse, according to God.
Okay.
So you're asking me based on my theology, Matt. You're asking me questions.
No, I don't care. No, Johnny, that's the thing. I don't care about what your personal theology is. I'm asking whether or not it makes... It is your personal theology. It absolutely... Everybody has their own personal theology. You can't speak for something else that's in somebody else's head. It is your personal theology. That's the way that works.
It's based on Scripture, Matt.
I don't care what it's based on. The point is, if I... Am I going to be judged? Am I going to be judged for not accepting Jesus?
I think you'll be judged based on your sins.
Okay.
You'll be judged according to the law.
What can I do to avoid
that? Nothing.
Good. Then I don't need to talk to you anymore. This is a waste of my time. Well, no, and a monumental waste of space. Because you're fine with the notion. You're fine with the notion that I could actively seek a God in desiring a relationship with that God. And if that God hides from me, then I deserve it. When
I don't think... I do not think you're actively seeking God because Scripture teaches
you're that correct. Man, I did it for decades, and now I'm not actively seeking God because it's a waste of time.
Matt, okay, fine.
Because you and everybody like you fails to provide any justification, Matt, and yet you make excuses for what would be gross immorality, which Matt, is holding someone accountable for something.
I'm trying to explain to you
that I don't need any more explanation from you because you are not going to engage in a reasonable discussion. You just want to preach. So let's move on to somebody else.
What's considered reasonable?
Johnny. I just told you I'm moving on to somebody else. Bye, Johnny.
Okay.
Johnny, you focus on reason, not doctrine, not dogma, not preaching.
I'm curious as to what Mr. Dillahunty thinks is, or what he considers to be reasonable.
I'm sorry that you don't understand what reason is. It's logical reasoning.
Well, you're not explaining it.
Well, if you'd shut the fuck up for a second, I will.
Oh, you've got the floor, sir.
Thank you. So, logic is founded on the principles of identity, non-contradiction, and excluded middle.
Okay.
That is how you determine it. You can draw it up in a Venn diagram. And so when we're arguing for something, we consider the evidence for it and we make a structured argument. And if an argument is structured in such a way that true premises would necessarily lead to a true conclusion, then you would need to come up with a syllogism where you put in premises and you reach a conclusion. Okay. Logic and reasoning is not the Bible says this, here's my personal interpretation of it, therefore we're done. That's not the way reasoning works. You must present a reasoned argument, and you must present one that is supported by evidence. And I've tried to ask you, based on your own understanding of theology, what you think about this. And all right, interrupt me one more time, Johnny.
Go ahead.
No, interrupt me one more time.
Look.
You ready? I'm talking right now. You're going to interrupt me one more time?
Go ahead, sir.
I'm done with you. I'll hang out for more stuff, but I'm done with you.
Well, that's fine. I still would like to at least say what I wanted to say.
I don't care what you'd like.
And other people can listen if they would like.
I think if we took a poll on which one of us spent more time talking and preaching and refusing to address what the other person said, you would win that poll.
Johnny, well, Matt, I want to ask you one thing, Johnny. You had mentioned earlier that your take on theology is not your take. I think that seems a little strange to me. Why shouldn't it be your take?
Well, I meant in a sense that this is not my personal Johnny-ism. I mean, I'm taking my position based on what Scripture teaches. That's what I'm saying. Is when I say it's not my take. Meaning that, you know, I just did not come up with this.
Of course, is it the Bible?
Well,
the big
no, point. It's multiple choice. It derives from Scripture. Is what I'm saying.
It is your theology that you're pushing. It's
yes.
You've chosen to focus on and not focus on. You can literally make the Bible say anything you want.
Well, okay, but I'm telling you what it says scripturally.
John,
I know. I can tell you something scripturally too. Murder someone.
So, Johnny, who decided? I want to know, Johnny, who decided for you that this doctrine is this theology is something that you should follow? If it's not your take on it, is that a decision that you made for yourself, or
well,
is that?
I'm trying to explain to you my take. I'm just going based on what the Scripture is teaching. And when I was talking to Matt, you know, I was looking at it from a sense of, okay, this is my worldview, and I'm trying to explain to you why God is, in a sense, what some people would look at as hiding. You know, look, God did, according to Scripture, God actually did not intend to save everyone, by the way. This is scriptural.
So now, you're saying now that that's your worldview, but then on another part,
yeah, it is
here because you're also saying that it's not your take, and it's in Scripture. So, you know, who's again? Are you making this decision to make this your worldview?
Well, I tried.
Are you just following without thinking about it? I'm curious.
No, I'm not following without thinking. I'm just trying to explain. When it comes across as my take, I did not want to insinuate that this is just a Johnny belief contrived from my own, you know, opinions and feelings and whatnot. I'm saying,
do you think that's a problem?
I'm saying that what I believe is derivative from what the Bible teaches. And I'm trying to explain to Matt, in regards to the sense that God is hiding, I actually agree with that.
Okay.
I do agree with that. And here again, as I pointed out, even in Scripture, it teaches in Jesus' time, even when he performed miracles, people saw and still did not believe. So it's not a matter of my job is to convince someone that God is real or that Jesus Christ is the truth, as he said.
My point is,
as far as it being someone's fault, you know, the question is, are you guilty of sin based on God's standards of sin? And the answer is going to be yes. So as far as assuming fault, you know, I know it seems like people want to try to put the blame on God, but we are guilty according to the judge. But saying, we are not all chosen to be saved. The idea that a person is seeking God, which is actually unbiblical because it teaches that we're not seeking God, and no one can come to God unless the Father draws him. That is what I tried to point out.
Okay, so I'm not blaming God here for this. You're the one who's saying that this is based on God's standard. So yes. In a sense, you're the one who's blaming God for that.
No.
We're free thinkers. We're thinking for ourselves, making our own determinations on what's right and wrong. And I think somehow you've made this determination and you're using the Bible as a source for that.
I'm a Christian.
But it seems to me the attitude that you're putting forward is that that's not okay for us to think for ourselves. We have to go along with what God is teaching.
No. You do not have to go along with what God is teaching. I'm saying that you're not going to go. It makes more sense to me that a non-believer is not going to go along with what Scripture teaches. I expect that. That's what I do expect. And when Christians try to go into conversations when atheists challenge them to prove God, I always find it strange that the Christian somehow in his mind or her mind thinks that they're going to present an argument and expect that, okay, since I've made this brilliant argument, that they're going to believe. And it's not even how they came to believe.
It's not even
through some sort of brilliant argument.
It's not supposed to be you that gives the argument. It's supposed to be the Holy Spirit working through you.
Yes, and it can only happen to those that God has chosen.
I've never seen the Holy Spirit work through anyone. I can
fine. You're not going to. You're not going to.
Hey guys.
Of course I have.
Hey Johnny, we're gonna move on to another person because we have a limited amount of time and a lot of people. I appreciate you coming on, and
thanks,
and
Johnny.
I will talk to you in the next couple of days if you're in one of the chats.
Yeah, hey, appreciate you, Justin. Matt, sorry we didn't have a very pleasant conversation, but I still respect you, sir, and it was a pleasure to meet you.
I still respect you, just not your views, because I don't know how to tell the difference between a God that's hiding and a God that doesn't exist. And your answer is that I can't tell the difference, which made all of this a monumental waste of time.
In a way, it is. In a way, it is.
Not just in a way. It's done, and I'm done wasting time.
Have a good night, Johnny.
Y'all take care.
If I could just ask something real quick, and then I've been on here long enough. Matt, I have an ideology that I work from, and I found it's the single best, simplest argument against Christianity, basically any religion that forces you to choose. And it's the simplest argument. And if you can shoot a hole through it, then I would appreciate it, because I'm always trying to sharpen my skills. So, and it comes down to a fundamental of, I'm just a person. I have no idea if there's, I don't see how I could ever understand if there is a God, much less what it wants. In Christianity and Judaism and Islam and Hinduism, all demand that you make a choice on the infinite. And I have no idea how I could even wrap my mind around that. And to me, that is like the single most easiest argument to dismantle any of these.
So there's a number of little problems there. Number one, when you say that Christianity expects you to make a choice, that's not necessarily true for all models of Christianity. As a matter of fact, for many of them, you don't make a choice at all. You are either chosen or you're not. So it's not just a thing about a choice, but also, even if you expand that to what you're trying to do to argue against a particular Christian model, cool. Now, how are you going to argue against the other models? Because for me, I'm an atheist in the sense that I do not accept that there is a God, because the God's claims that I've been presented with have failed to meet their burden of proof. Mm-hmm. What I get from theists is, well, it's obvious. I mean, granted, I'm going to lump Johnny in the monumental waste of time category, because when you go to Romans 1:20 and you just say, well, it's obvious that God exists, but you won't believe it, and God's going to either reveal himself to you or not, you don't have any say in it, there's nothing you can do, then what's the point in telling someone to give the reason for why they have this belief? What's the point in, you know, witnessing and sharing? If God wants me, he can come get me. If God has any interest in me, he can demonstrate that he exists. And this is why when people say, what would change your mind, Matt? What would change your mind? And I say, I have no idea, because it doesn't matter what would change my mind. It doesn't matter even if I know what would change my mind, because I don't. It's just going to depend on the God claim. But any being that anyone is pointing to as a God would absolutely need to know exactly what would change my mind. Otherwise, you know, this God's not particularly knowledgeable. Mm-hmm. So that God would know what would change my mind. And this God should be capable of doing the thing that would change my mind. Otherwise, I'm more powerful than God.
Well, that's the whole point I'm making, is that I have no idea. God's never presented himself to itself.
Exactly. And so if Johnny were still here, then Johnny's response to that is basically, you're just screwed. You aren't one of the chosen. Why am I spending any time talking to you? And that's why I was done with Johnny. Because anybody who's going to come in to say, oh, well, maybe you didn't try hard enough, or maybe God just hasn't chosen you, or whatever else. Those are all fine answers, as long as you're not also suggesting that I'm somehow unreasonable for not believing it. And Johnny wants to have his cake and eat it too. And I don't care for cake that much.
Thank you so much for your time. I'll let someone else come in. Thank you so much. This was such a thrill. Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Justin.
For Ross in chat, I'm not going to be on that much longer. I'm definitely not going to go through foundationalism. And I think if you Google foundherentism, which is a combination of foundationalism and coherentism, which is something that was put forward by Susan Hawk, you will find, or maybe Hack, I apologize if I mispronounced her name, you'll find basically kind of where I am on epistemology. Plus, I'm also doing it this Saturday. Sorry. So what's next? Because I only got like 10 minutes left.
Okay,
it's
cool.
A pleasure to meet you, Matt. I just wanted to say thanks a lot for resharing MathPig's posting about the True North Talk program that Neil, the 604 Atheist, and I will be co-hosting. We really appreciate the support. Thank you so much. And we will be promoting your shows from there as well. I just have a couple of quick questions, if you don't mind. There's a couple of things that come up in these conversations that I've had with theists. One of them is, now I'll list them both first, and then fun one at the end. It seems to me a lot of the Christians and Muslims will, it's like they're redefining the word death by removing its sense of finality, its characteristic of finality when they talk about the afterlife. And I'm just wondering if you have some thoughts on what the origins of that might be, like what, from I guess more of a linguistic side of things, if you have some perspective on that. The other thing I'm wondering about is, talking with different Christians over time, it seems that there is some disagreement on which parts belong to New Testament and which parts belong to Old Testament. Denominational thing?
So first of all, I'm not sure I understood the first part of the question, but when you say that there's confusion between what's New Testament and what's Old Testament,
Who has that confusion?
Because I've got five Bibles sitting next to me. It's really easy to figure out which testament something's
in. But I've had some Christians in conversations that will even fight with each other and say, no, that part is from the Old Testament and this part's from the New Testament.
What difference does it make? Are they saying that the Old Testament doesn't matter anymore? Because the Old Testament, by the way, has the creation story, sin, the fall, the Ten Commandments, all the prophecy. If you throw out the Old Testament, you have no Christianity.
Oh, I agree with you.
It's not just when Paul says that, you know, if Christ be not raised, then all our faith is in vain. That's also true for if Genesis isn't correct, and if Exodus isn't correct, and if Deuteronomy isn't correct, because all of those things lead up to it. You don't have any prophecies. You don't have anything. So you don't have original sin. There's nothing to be saved from or towards. So you don't get to just chuck out the Old Testament.
No.
I agree with that. Yeah, and it's that's why it's all included in that Bible. It's just it's an interesting thing I've encountered a few times. I'm just wondering if you've come across that. And
yeah, I did an entire video called But That's the Old Testament, where I go through a number of claims from Christians about certain Christians. I mean, it's you can't generalize all of it, but it's that's the Old Testament. And I'm like, hang on, so is the Ten Commandments, so is creation, so is the fall, so is original sin. I mean, everything, it's all there. Now, you can maybe chuck out the begats, because they're not that important or fun.
And I haven't even heard of them.
And I know that there's people who are perhaps not too keen to read certain portions of the Old Testament because they find it distasteful. But the same thing happened with the New Testament when they're creating the canon, where one of my favorite books, the Apocalypse of Peter, which was considered to be authoritative scripture, was excluded from the Bible, mainly because, at least the understanding from the scholars that I read, is that people didn't like reading it from church because it gives literal descriptions of hell, of people being tormented and stuff. And because they didn't like to read it, it just fell by the wayside.
Isn't that the same book that talks about the giant cross coming up, basically floating in the air?
I'm not recalling that part right now, but it does have the descriptions of like the homosexuals jumping off the mountain into a pile of the homosexuals. And then as they would be driven down to the ground by the new ones that were landing on top of them. Mm-hmm. And then would crawl out from underneath and come back up. And liars were had their tongues stabbed. Basically, the Apocalypse of Peter was the foundation for Dante's Inferno. And most of the concepts that most modern people have about hell come from that book, because there's not much about hell in the Bible, or not much left.
So last question I want to ask you. I saw your presentation with Jordan Peterson, and I thought that was a very interesting conversation. I really enjoyed it, and I liked how you kind of held him to certain points, and he ended up having to answer stuff he normally avoids. But one thing I remember from there, and this is the fun part, you mentioned that you had a hallucination once of a super strawberry went flying around. Could you elaborate on that a little bit, like a little more description of this strawberry character? It's just...
I was on acid. I was staring at a wood grain on a door, and it turned into a strawberry with eyes and a face and a big ass and a cape, and it flew off the door and did a lap around me and then slammed back into the door.
It's like a super strawberry kind of.
Yeah, it was that's what I called it. It was super strawberry.
You should get one. You should get this made up and put on your desk for these shows.
It's a t-shirt idea.
I might do, but I mean, it's only there for. It doesn't do any good for my work when it comes to like debating theists.
Yeah.
It primarily is only useful for a segment of the atheist population or a segment of the woo-woo population that thinks that, oh, because people experience godlike things on DMT, therefore, you know, they're touching on something real. And I'm like, why on earth would you think that a brain altered by chemicals is giving you something more accurate and more true than the brain that's not? That your entirely subjective experience is somehow a truth rather than, you know, you're just high and seeing stuff.
Yeah.
My sense of it is that they're losing, because science keeps uncovering more, as Neil deGrasse Tyson pointed out, ever receding pocket of scientific ignorance. And so it seems that they're trying to reach out into science and use science to justify things now, because they've run out of other things. Maybe that's partly what that is.
Possibly. I really don't know.
Thank you very much for everything you do for the atheism community. I really do appreciate it.
Sure. Yeah. I got just a couple minutes left. I will try to give shorter answers and maybe engage with people more at another time, because we kind of went on for a while with
Johnny. So I just want to introduce real quick. I think Greg wants to try and get back on a few minutes of what he was talking about before he jumped off. But we also have Kirk and Angelise in the room. They are frequent flyers with the after parties. They are actually of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, so they're fun to talk to. They're absolutely awesome. Fantastic people. And we also have Skids the Clown, who's a frequent flyer with our after parties too.
Hey, I apologize that we don't have more time, but...
Yeah.
Oh, not a problem.
It's all good, just hearing.
Matt, something that struck me as a Christian, I remember after the movie God's Not Dead, talking to several atheists and having them say, gosh, you know, the thing that bothered me about that movie was that it depicted that the reason why I didn't have a relationship with God or whatever, had fallen away from God, was because I was mad. There was something that happened in my life that hurt me. And it struck me because my conversations with atheists had not always gone down that pathway. There was
it
a reason.
It does happen.
Yeah, it does happen. But that wasn't every atheist story. And it struck me that as a Christian, if I always come to an atheist and I'm always talking to him and saying, or as if God did something wrong to them in their life that they're hurt over, and that's the reason
what
why
happened.
From God.
What happened to you? Yeah. What happened? Yeah. Who hurt you? Yeah.
That was pretty degrading to that person, and probably was downplaying what may be the real reason, which is that they hadn't found a reason to believe.
Yeah.
And they hadn't seen the evidence. And if we didn't have that conversation, we weren't really being real with each other.
Yeah, I had this has come up. I mean, I did a debate in Canada many, many years ago, and it was a team debate, me and Chris DiCarlo against two ministers whose names I'm going to forget. And one of them just irked me because he immediately went to his view is that unlike different from Johnny, which is why there's lots of different views. And why I don't lump every Christian in one bucket or every God believer in one bucket. His view was the Bible says that if you seek God and you ask for God to reveal himself to you, that God will absolutely do that. That's this particular pastor's view. And so his view on me then was that I just didn't try hard enough, or my heart wasn't in the right place, or my heart, you know, that this was essentially my fault. That's incredibly annoying, because I was, you know, when I walked down the aisle at the age of 5, I was active in the church and all this other stuff. I hear from people whose grand revelation of God is not too far above, hey, God help me find my car keys. And whereas my thing here was, I was a sincere believer, begging God daily to provide, you know, information, because my roommate was destined for hell and I was, you know, working to become with the intention of being a minister. Let me correct that, just because everybody gets information all wrong. I was never a minister. I was working with the goal of becoming a minister. When I found my way out, I saved myself a little hassle. It's like, it's the reason why the key aspect of the show that I do, the Atheist Experience, is where I ask, tell me what you believe and why. Because if somebody just called up and said, hi, I'm a follower of Jesus, and I made all kinds of assumptions about them based on other followers of Jesus that I made and told them why they were wrong. Well, that's not, first of all, it's not skepticism. It's not any way to get to the truth. You know, I don't do a show just so I can smack people around and say, oh, you're wrong. You're right. Oh, look how stupid you are. You're wrong. It's tell me what you believe and why. And I will point out either where it's fallacious or ask questions about, like, you know, like when I ended the thing with Johnny, I technically ended it earlier, but when I ended it the second time, it was, I don't know how to tell the difference between a God that's hiding and a God that doesn't exist. And Johnny's answer is you can't, which is why it was useless. But many Christians have an answer where they say you can. Here's the things that you can do to be reasonably assured that this is real or that this God exists, or to put yourself in the right frame rate. Now, there we go, back to gaming again. Put yourself in the right frame of mind, or put your heart in the right place where, you know, God can reveal himself. So yeah, your point is great, Greg. We can't. I wish people wouldn't assume things about atheists that aren't true, and I wish people wouldn't assume things about theists that aren't true.
Right. No, I hear you. Yeah, it was interesting about the hidden God concept. One of the things that I had gotten to in a conversation with Bryce, who you spoke with earlier at one point, was, you know, if God is a God who says that he wants that none should perish, that all would have eternal life, then it means that his will is that all would come to him, right? It would seem that way.
Well,
and if that's the case, and yet when you sought him, you didn't find him, the logical conclusion is either he doesn't exist, which I will give you, that is a possibility.
That's not the conclusion I reached, though.
Okay.
My answer has been for years.
Okay.
If there's a God, God knows what should convince me, should be capable of doing it. And the fact that this hasn't happened either means that this God does not exist or that this God is not interested in convincing me he exists. Yeah, either way.
By and those choice be- or by either his, he's unable to convince you or he chooses not to convince you. Those are my other two options.
Well, if he's unable to convince me, then I'm more powerful than God.
That's no, right. Then he's not God. So that one should be out.
Right. Which means and either he doesn't exist.
That he's not... The other one about him not being there is not an option from my theology. And I understand.
Okay. So what option have I missed?
The other option is that it's by choice. That the one that you concluded was that he chooses not to.
Not to reveal himself. That's fine. But now we're in the same, now we're back to Johnny's thing. And the thing is, my conclusion is, God could convince me and either doesn't because he doesn't exist or because he doesn't want to. Either way, it's not my problem.
Right.
Yeah. That's up to God. That's all I've ever said. It's not my problem. It's not up to Johnny.
It's not up to me. It's up to God to convince you.
Angelisa has been waiting for ages here to chime in and ask something. And technically, I'm going to go a few minutes over time just so I can do that. But thank you, Greg. Appreciate it.
And thank you. I appreciate your time.
By the way, my ex-wife has watched God's Not Dead at least 13 or 14 times. Every time someone would come to the house,
yes,
and she'd find out they hadn't seen God's Not Dead, she's like, oh my gosh, you have to watch it. And part of it is because when Kevin Sorbo gave an interview about how he came up with his professor character, there's a suspicion that I was at least a part of it because he talked about a leader of an atheist organization on a call-in show in one interview. And I was like... That's not quite me, but I'll take it.
Hey, I would love to have a prolonged conversation with you in the future. I understand you've got other people to get to. I'm going to duck off too, in case you want to. But thank you so much. I appreciate it.
Sure, thank you.
It was probably you, Matt.
I'm not bothered either way. Thanks so much for your patience, Angelisa. I want to make sure we at least got started on this. So, hey.
Oh, well... I probably might defer to Jesse. I just have some like comments here and there that I put in the chat, and that's why I like to be part of it. I do think there's a fifth option, and it kind of is a segue from the he hasn't chosen to reveal. We believe that God has perfect timing, right? So.
Oh.
I know.
I missed it because I usually include the word yet.
Oh, see.
Either God doesn't exist or he doesn't want me to know he exists, comma, yet. Yeah. That's the way I normally answered. I skipped it today.
Right. And we don't subscribe to original sin. So that's one deferment that we have away from like some of. So sure. What would you say to people who believe that it wasn't a sin, it was a plan, and that we're somewhat... He has these contingencies to deal with our free will because we believe in free will, free agency, free will.
I believe in will. How free it is, I don't know. But for the question you're asking is how would you answer these people? It's my answer is always the same. Please demonstrate what the reasoning is why I should be convinced of this, and that's going to preclude obviously personal revelation because it's revelation to you and it's hearsay to me at best. And right. So all I ever want to know is what you believe and why, what's the reason. And for a lot of people, it comes down to they don't think that I should be convinced. They don't think that I've, you know, they would agree, Matt, you don't have a good reason to be convinced, but they do. And my response to that is that if we're talking about objective reality, either God is manifest and detectable in reality or he's not. And I'm using he just as a lump thing. I don't care about the gender of a deity.
Nor but either do I. God is, or the color of the skin or anything.
Yeah, yeah. Either God is detectable, manifests in reality in some detectable way, or it doesn't. And if God doesn't manifest in reality in any detectable way, then we're done talking because there's nothing to investigate if there's no active manifestation in reality. If God does manifest in reality in a way that we can detect, then somebody needs to say, here's how we detect it, and here's how we know what it is and how we can confirm it's God. And nobody's done that.
Well, you want a perfect formulation like you can have in other, like math and whatnot. But
no, I don't. I just want a good reason. People can convince me of anything if they just provide evidence. And yet every time I ask this, what I get is not evidence. It's just more claims.
Right.
Yeah, because we do believe in personal revelation. So, right. How am I going to prove to you what my revelation is? Like, I had an incident right before the show where I was like, my goodness, why don't I listen to that guidance that I'm given from, I believe, God, because he wants me to have joy in this lifetime and not just the one to come.
How do you know that?
How do I know that? Because of my everyday experiences, and it's so far as like to the little minuscule things that he cares about. Like, I was going to, and this might not be a good example, but it's an example I have. I was going to go to pick up my prescription, and I felt like I should go to the one Walmart, but I was like, no, you should really go to the other one. But I ignored it because I wanted to go to the other one. I went to that one. They didn't have my prescription. And by the time I got to the one that I had been directed to by the spirit.
So how do you know that you were directed to the other one by the spirit?
Because I live by the spirit, because I, every day when I follow the promptings.
How do you tell the difference between living by the spirit and living by your own brain?
And that's what I'm saying. I couldn't have known that Walmart was the correct Walmart to go to, but
you
the
didn't.
Spirit did.
You didn't, yes, and there's did. No, and there's no there's no demonstration that there was a spirit talking to you, or the spirit knew something in your mind said, hey, you should go to this other one, and it turns out that in this case, that actually turned out to be the case. But if they had your prescription at the one that you went to, you wouldn't be telling this story now, and you wouldn't even care that you had a feeling or an impression that you should go to another Walmart. This is cherry picking. You are collecting. Yes, it absolutely is cherry picking. You are remembering the hits and ignoring the misses. And when I ask you, how do you know that it's a spirit that guided you? Your answer is because the spirit knew and was right. Well, that's not evidence.
Well, and I wish I could like write down every single time I have experiences like this, because I could show you that it's not cherry picking. Like every single day I'm guided.
Why haven't you done that then? Because you could win, you could get $1 million from the James Randi Educational Foundation, or at least once upon a time, if you actually chronicled these impressions. And why is it that you're doing
it? It's a good thing, because God has said that we should keep a history, which is a journal.
Also, but I mean, granted, you're LDS, right? I don't know. So when the Bible, not the Book of Mormon, but when the Bible says, thou shalt not put the Lord thy God to the test, wouldn't keeping a note of every time the Spirit reveals something to you, and so that you could confirm it, wouldn't that be putting God to the test?
It's not about confirming it. It's just about keeping a journal of my history. Okay. And so it's not testing it. It's actually just going along and showing when I can call it remembrance too.
So when the spirit told you to go to the other Walmart, did the spirit know that you weren't going to?
No.
So the spirit had no idea that you were not going to follow its instructions. So why would the spirit waste time?
Because that's me. I chose to go against the spirit.
Yes, but. And you're saying the spirit didn't know that you were going to choose against it?
The spirit is the Holy Ghost. It's not God.
Okay. Well, so why would the spirit tell you something? Wow. Okay. Okay. I get it. So you're saying that the spirit has no idea what you're going to do.
No, so what the spirit is a comforter, a guide. What else? There's a couple of other things, but
I'm just trying to look at this to analyze as quick as efficiently as we can. Mm-hmm. Let's say there's two Walmarts, A and B, and you are intent on going to A, and the spirit comes and says you should go to B. Now, the spirit had to know that you were going to A, otherwise it wouldn't have bothered to tell you to go to B. If the spirit thought you were going to B, it wouldn't have said anything because you were already going to B, right?
I went to A.
No. I'm saying if you had been going to B, then the spirit wouldn't have said anything to you because you were already going to the place that it wanted you to go.
Well, I was like, which one should I go to? I thought
wait,
had that
you, wait, no, no, no. Did you, you got in your car and you asked the spirit, which Walmart should I go to? And it said B, and you went to A?
Yes, I went again.
So clearly, you don't have enough confidence in the spirit revealing accurate information to you. No, otherwise, you would not have ignored it.
No, because I did what Justin said, and I was determined to get my grace.
So you have more confidence in Justin than you do in the Holy Spirit. That's what you did.
All hail Justin.
I had more of a desire to get my great energy drink.
Uh-huh.
And only that one at A, only Walmart A has my energy drink.
I tell
but
you what.
What I really needed was B.
I tell you, here's what you need. Here's what you can do, Angelisa. And then I really have to go because I'm 10 minutes over when I said I would call my girlfriend. Here's what you can do.
Uh-huh.
Can you ask the spirit to reveal things to you?
Yeah, but that doesn't mean it's necessarily going to happen, but sure.
Okay.
I can ask.
So ask the spirit what you should say to me.
You always do this.
And then email me with whatever the spirit says, because that is a knockdown, indisputable money. The only thing that can be better is if the spirit also told you what number I'm thinking of. But if the spirit, if you ask the spirit, no, not even close. But
I guess 42.
You would have guessed 42 and you'd have been wrong. But that once upon a time I did. I have thought of both 3 and 42 in the past. But so if you ask the spirit what you should say to me, if you say, hey, what should I say to Matt? And the spirit tells you something, it clearly has to be the right thing to say to me. And I will, I mean, you have access here. You can get my email, whatever else. If you come up with an actual message that the spirit told you to deliver me,
okay,
I'll do a hangout with you live and you can tell me what it is and we can discuss it. And if you don't get a message from the spirit about me, that's fine too.
I will. Yeah. Matt? I won't do it. I try to live just by the spirit. So if I don't get an answer or something to ask you, I won't bother you.
Sure. And it's not a bother. I've enjoyed this. I wish we'd just started talking instead of the time wasting with Johnny, who basically says, oh, God's obvious, but he's not going to reveal himself to you, so you're screwed. That's silly to me.
Matt,
but this is much better.
Thank you so much for coming on.
I might suggest you also ask for future lottery numbers.
Yeah, yeah.
That's not going to happen.
No, that's not. It's so I can have my own personal joy and that I be guided or comforted or whatever I need through the spirit. And it's a message from God, but yeah.
Matt, thank you.
On that note, I'm going to bow out. I'm going to let you guys continue. Thanks so much. I appreciate it. Thanks for your time and the patience. I apologize to anybody I didn't get to. Maybe we'll do another hangout another time.
Is there a possibility? Richard Mattson in the chat had asked a question. If you could just throw, if you could throw an answer in the chat for him real quick.
I don't know what. How long ago was it?
He just a few minutes ago. He asked, "What would your answer from God would be experientially?" I'm not really understanding the question.
I don't understand the question either, but maybe we'll come back in and do it again.
All right, cool. Thank you so much, Matt, for coming on.
I got to run.
You have a wonderful night.
Thank you, guys.
Thanks, Matt. So thanks from Canada.
Absolutely.
Hey.
That was.
My son used to have a bumper sticker that he put up in his locker at school that said, "Blame Canada."
Oh, he's a South Park fan. Yeah, South Park gets us right, actually. The only part they got wrong was Saddam Hussein. He's never taken over here. But everything else they got right. And
not that you know.
Yeah, right? That was a really nice conversation there. I enjoyed listening to all of that. So, yeah, thanks for coming on.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, thank me?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah. I don't... choose to get into arguments or proving my point of view.
I don't think anybody else noticed.
They're not laughing on us. They might be laughing about me.
No. Nobody noticed, Greg. Nobody noticed. I wonder if anybody in the chat noticed.
I know. Get it right, dude.
Yes, Greg was running to his room to get a shirt.
He pulled a drag knot.
That ain't right, man. That ain't right. I bowed out.
Bringing a salt partner to me, this is wonderful. You did great.
So, Jesse? I noticed that you shook your head when I said it wasn't it was a message from like the spirit versus from God. I guess I kind of worded that like I heard it through the spirit, but it is, yes, it is a message from God because he does care about our everyday life.
I don't know. The way I heard it was that you were saying that the Holy Spirit isn't God.
Well, yeah, because we don't believe that it's Trinity. We don't believe in the Trinity. We believe in that there's three separate beings. So, yeah, we'll disagree on that.
Well, that's where I'd give a shout out to my friend, my Muslim friend, Hatim. We discussed this issue actually earlier this week on whether or not the Holy Spirit was God. And you see in Acts 5 where Ananias and Sapphira lie to Peter, and Peter responds to him saying that you have not lied to men, but to God, referring to the Holy Spirit. So, I mean, I can give the exact verse if you want, but it's pretty unequivocal. There's a couple instances of that in Acts where the explicit connection is made, where you don't actually have to rely on theological inference to get to that point. But that's where it's like, I think it's pretty clear, even with regard to Genesis 1, that the Holy Spirit is God.
Well, he's one in purpose, but he's not one in the same person. But in fact, I wouldn't
affirm one in personhood either.
No.
So if the God knows everything, why does it matter whether you lie to your God?
Because you're doing it temporally. You're willfully choosing to lie with what freedom you have as a creature.
Mm-hmm.
So there's an expectation that we won't lie about anything.
No, that's not what I said. So, you have an expectation to act responsibly within what volitional freedom you have, right? So, yes, Hulk Hogan coming up on Jesus. That's
Randy
it,
Savage, actually.
That is Randy.
Oh, is that Randy Savage? Oh, I'm sorry. Yes, I'm on my phone. Savage. Too small a screen.
I actually forgot that I had that screen shared earlier as I put it up when Matt was talking about Randy Savage. I thought it would be good timing to show it on the screen then.
I mean, that's almost like the issue of like, that's almost like asking the same question that people were asking, like or that Matt D was presenting to the chat group, like, well, if God is omniscient, then he would know what I would need to convince me. It's a ludicrous question. That's essentially Matthew. I believe it's Matthew 12. I could be incorrect. Matthew 9 or 12. I always get those two chapters mixed up. But it's like the blaspheming of the Holy Spirit, right? The reason that that God doesn't give you that which would persuade you is because nothing can persuade you of the truth, because you necessarily see God as evil. Sure, it's a circular argument. Whatever. Makes sense. Coherent. Like, that's what the case.
It seems strange to me that there's discouragement of this lying to God, and then on the other hand, you're saying that we have the freedom to do this, but it's like you're saying we're misusing our freedom if we lie to God?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that sounds like an imposition to me. That sounds like oppression, almost. It kind of leads to it.
Yeah, you're darn right. The oppression of righteousness. Right?
Okay.
That's why Paul calls it that we're slaves to righteousness, right? Those of us that are redeemed, we give up our freedom to sin, and we are then bond servants of Christ. We're slaves to Christ.
You're talking about Christians now. Okay.
Yeah.
Well, explicitly in that sense, that's why you perceive it as oppression, because necessarily you're not a Christian. We perceive it as liberty.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
It's liberty to us.
I don't blame freedom for any of this.
Oh, but sure, that's fine. That's also like, for example, what you could say is the lack of guilt with regard to one's volition of sin. Because necessarily, in order to justify hell for eternity, you have to be free of guilt toward your sin, just like the rich man was toward Lazarus. Right? He didn't ask Lazarus for a drop of water on his tongue. He sought Abraham. He didn't ask for forgiveness. He didn't even acknowledge his existence. That's necessarily a precondition for hell, is that those that are in hell do not have guilt. They do not receive the conviction of the Holy Spirit to correct their sin. That's why there's no forgiveness of that sin, because necessarily the conviction which corrects you perceive as evil.
I could see the logic in that line of thinking. I do see it somewhat.
Correct.
Yeah.
This is one of the problems I have with this idea that atheists are going to go to hell because we're not Christians. And this is an idea that comes up, is presented quite frequently on social media. Anyway, I'm not saying you're presenting it, but the idea that and what seems strange to me is that there'd be something like a lie or some kind of a sin committed that's done in this finite world. And then there's an infinite punishment for it. Is that how this actually works from your understanding?
Repeat that with regard to punishment one more time.
Okay, yeah. So the idea is, my understanding of going to hell is that you're there for eternity. You're suffering for eternity for your sins. But the sins don't seem to be based on an infinite crime. They're more a finite crime.
Who do you commit them against? The crimes.
I'm asking about what justifies making an infinite punishment for a finite crime.
Yeah, right. So I'm asking the question. There's some echo.
I guess it depends on
is that me,
who the victim is. It varies, I suppose. I don't see why that's relevant. I'm not thinking of a specific crime. I'm talking about the concepts here.
Yeah, so am I. So that's where what I'm getting at, for example, is with regard to David sinning against Bathsheba and Uriah the Hittite and killing Uriah the Hittite, and that his sin of adultery might be covered up with Bathsheba. He says in Psalm 51 that against you, Lord, alone have I sinned, right? The issue is necessarily is that when you sin against one of God's creations, you're sinning primarily against him, because creation is only an image bearer of the true subject of that image, which is God. So what you're doing necessarily is you're not sinning against some kind of a creature primarily, or something that's lesser than God. You are primarily sinning against God because you see that image and seek to be malevolent toward it. Okay? So that's where then it's not a infinite punishment against a finite crime. It's an infinite punishment against an infinite crime, because that infinite crime then is also sought perpetually. That's where you do not seek, in the condition of hell, as I previously mentioned, you do not seek repentance. The only people that go to hell are those who seek the rationalization toward their sin perpetually and without cessation. They do not desire conviction. They look at conviction as evil. So it's not even with reference to a finite crime. It's with reference to a infinite crime with which one infinitely rationalizes.
So adultery is something that you mentioned. And so adultery would be, even if it just happened once, that still qualifies as a sin, I suppose. And that one would result in eternity of punishment. You see why it doesn't make sense to me?
No, it doesn't.
Did you hear anything that I said?
I was listening. And
okay, so it's not a finite crime.
You're saying adultery is an act against the God who is infinite, but I don't see why you're something that's going to be surviving forever is relevant to this.
Right.
Punishment should be more fitting to the action, should it not?
Mm-hmm. Yes. Absolutely. And that's the issue, is that it quite rightly is, because it is not, the crime is not only confined to the committance of that crime, but also the rationalization that one utilizes in justifying their committance of that crime. Nobody goes to hell repenting of the crime they committed. Anyone who goes to hell is necessarily in a condition where they rationalize the crime that they committed, and they do not have a desire to be contrite and repentant of that crime. Necessarily. That's a necessary precondition for hell.
I don't think that's ethical. I think that's unethical to assign an infinite punishment for an act like that.
Yeah, well, that's right. We're in Psalm 18:26. It's essentially that to the unrighteous, God seems torturous, right? Mm-hmm. So it's not surprising that would be the outcome of your perspective.
That's pretty convenient, by the way.
Of course it is. Of course it is, because I would expect God's truth to be not only transparent but convenient.
It's convenient to you because it's written to stack the cards on your side.
No, not on my side. I'm as equally condemned as you. No.
Anybody who does not agree with you is obviously on the opposite side of the stack.
No, that stack condemns me daily. I am condemned every single day that I wake up and take a breath of fresh air. I promise you, I am no less sinless than you are. I promise you, that law does not favor me. It condemns me as much as it does you.
Actually, it condemns him more because he knows more. So with more knowledge comes more accountability. So he and the people who have more knowledge, so you're not judged the same way Jesse is judged because you don't have the same understanding that Jesse does.
So
we're judged based on our understanding.
It would be horrible for anybody to go on a mission trip to an indigenous island and present evidence and knowledge to people who would get the free pass because they know nothing about the theology.
Exactly.
Well, you're saying for them to learn about Jesus, which is not how they.
You're presenting them an opportunity to go to hell.
Yes. Your presentation of anything is only the means to God's ultimate outcome. It's Acts 17:26. Okay, God places everybody in particular locations with particular boundaries that they may feel their way and perhaps find God, and that is within His sovereignty.
Yeah. So you're not going to, like, even all of us who have not heard the message are not judged without hearing the message. So whether that's, you know, before the second coming or during, you know, when the second coming happens, that doesn't mean that they're going to be judged for their not knowing something. It's only upon their knowing and complete understanding thereof. That's why you cannot blaspheme unless you completely know God.
You know, so and this is where I would diverge.
You're saying there kind of has to be some intention, which would be requiring understanding.
Full knowledge of. If you have a full knowledge of God, and then you blaspheme against the Spirit and against God, then you are going to go to hell. You are going to stay there, and you've earned the ticket there. But it's only after you have a full knowledge. And there's very few of us who have such a full knowledge of Him that would make us a son of perdition, that would make us so that we would be in that place.
Well,
we all have hope.
If I may, right, this is, so the Angelisa, this isn't me like having a debate with you, right, but this is me trying to give an olive branch to the atheist in the room, right? Romans 1, where Matt wanted to attack Johnny for that issue earlier, I'm going to affirmatively agree with Johnny in the sense that the knowledge that is sufficient to condemn man to separation from God is explicated in Romans 1 as being the invisible attributes. Okay, that is absent of the explicit revelation mentioned in Romans 2 and 3. You do not have to have access to Scripture to be accountable for the deeds that you commit. Why? Because the law of God is written upon man's heart. That is why everybody in these chats sit here and argue over morality, whether it's subjective, objective, and if it's subjective, then how do we pursue that ideal outcome, right? How do we make this world a better place? That's why we sit here and argue over these things, is because necessarily we have that law in our hearts, but some of us suppress it to greater or lesser extents.
I think you're making a very large claim for religion there by saying that it is the overall authority.
I mean, it's not my claim. It's Romans 1 or 2.
How do I know that means anything?
You track the consistency.
I don't recognize it as a valid law.
I agree.
That's fine. Oh, that's fine. That's not a surprise. That's fine.
Yeah,
of course it's not a surprise to you.
I mean, it's not, right? And it's not a surprise to anyone. Like, for example, if me and Justin argued on any particular, no, just as a random point, if me and Justin were arguing on any given day over some kind of issue, right? It's a subjective issue between me and him, right? Morally speaking, we're going to disagree at some point, right? And we're going to use all of these rationales as to why it's correct or incorrect. Excuse me.
And to be fair, I would say it's not a surprise to me that you believe this.
But it's, yeah, exactly. It's not. These things have been argued from the dawn of time. These are very old discussions. They're not new discussions. So me and him are going to disagree. We're going to disagree on how we come to that objective outcome. We're both seeking the objective necessarily, but we have different rationalizations as to how to get there and where it ends. It's not
I'm seeing an objective. Well, let's hear what Angelisa has to say, and then I want to hear what you think the objective is.
To be fair.
I had to put. I literally put my shirt on backwards for you guys for that one.
Yeah, because I feel like every single show, right, Justin?
Every single show, every conversation, everything. If you guys want it, we got it. We got the Empathetic Atheist shirts with the "To Be Fair" on the back of it. It's on the Facebook page, I think it is. Or if you go to our website, empatheticatheist.com, you can find it there too.
I'm just curious. I'd like to know which objective it is that Jesse is thinking that I'm trying to reach. It wasn't clear to me. Maybe I missed part of what he said there.
He's muted, so I guess he's running away. He's running away.
Yeah, sorry. I was typing. I'm not saying that there is any one particular objective that you are pursuing. I'm saying that there is an ideal to that objectivity that you pursue and I pursue. We disagree about what that ideal is, but nonetheless, we both believe that there are such moral absolutes, that they are so universal and transcendent that they should be imposed upon each other. So what about torturing a child?
I don't believe
literally sticking a knife into the flesh of a child.
Oh, that's just pretty graphic.
Just for the fun of it. Let's take a knife against the little infant, right?
Well, first, I'm going to say that immoral? I'm going to say that's not fun at all. But
is it immoral? I didn't say it was fun.
My own subjective opinion, that's wrong. Absolutely.
Did you say objective or subjective?
My own subjective opinion.
Okay. Is it immoral enough that if you saw someone doing that in front of you, that you would impose your morality upon them to prevent them from doing that?
That's not how it should be phrased, because that's not what
it's exactly how it should be phrased.
No, I would be trying to save the child.
Because you believe that it's immoral. The child's life, the child's bodily autonomy and health matter to you.
But I know that the person doing the attack disagrees with me on this subjective morality. Mm-hmm. So you don't care about their opinion enough to stop them. Hang on. So we cannot agree on what is me and the attacker cannot make an objective assessment on what is moral, what is right or wrong.
It's a very poor argument because in that moment you don't care. You don't care about him.
Let me finish. You and I both think it's wrong. So you and I can make an objective assessment or a non-subjective assessment on this. But there's probably many other things that you and I disagree on. So we can't come to make objective assessments on those things.
That wasn't my claim, was it? My claim is necessarily not that there are objective assessments in which then one can decide against the other and then we all agree that objectively it's correct. It is nonetheless that you and me both believe that morally speaking there are particular ideals that we should pursue. And in the instance of some psychotic murderer who wants to take a knife against a child, you are so willing to impose your moral will against that individual to prevent them from harming an infant. Okay, that is nonetheless the imposition, your objective imposition of another.
It is subjective
because you're forcefully preventing them from doing so. That's objectively true.
It's subjective. My sense of morality is subjective, even in that case.
I'm not arguing that your sense of morality is not subjective. I'm agreeing that it's subjective, but it is an objectively moral imposition. You believe it to be true enough that you impose your will against another and prevent them by force from doing it.
And how does this get you any closer to God?
It is not getting me closer to God.
No, we're not making that argument.
I'm not making that argument.
We're arguing morality.
No. Right.
We can all agree there's some things morally that we all agree on.
Right. And we're going on a road that's taking us away from the previous conversation.
All I'm arguing necessarily is that, excuse me, lots of garlic in my dinner tonight.
Hell yeah.
All I'm arguing is that necessarily is that in this instance, You believe that your determination is so objectively correct that you're willing to impose it upon others. You
I
do make.
I just told you it's not objectively correct.
I am not saying that upon the omniscience of God it is universally objective. Listen to my words very carefully. Okay. You and you alone believe that it is so morally objective that it is worthwhile that you impose your morally objective opinion onto another in that instance.
I'm not saying it's morally objective. I have not said that at all. I do not believe that.
Alrighty then. You're not listening to me.
I already pointed out to you that I know the person doing the attack has a different sense of what's right and wrong. Otherwise, they wouldn't be doing that action. So I'm going to be defending a child against somebody who disagrees with me morally. I know that we both have subjective moral views on that point.
Okay.
Well, that being said, I am going to end the show. We are going to, for you guys, we are going to, what I always do is I keep it open. I keep the room open. We're actually recording on StreamYard right now. What I do is I keep the show open after we're done with the live on YouTube, and then I take that recording and I post it on my Patreon account for my patrons to see the behind-the-scenes conversation that happens after the show ends. Sometimes the gloves come off a little bit more. I'm not exactly around all the time to moderate, but so it kind of gives you that that gloves off if you want it. But when we're on the show, I love how you guys have really good conversations. We keep things calm. I know things got a little riled up with Matt and Johnny before, but I mean that was coming. It actually happened a few minutes later than I thought it was going to. but yeah, it was awesome having Matt on. Thank you for everybody that hung out with us tonight for the main show and the after party. Like I said before, if this is your first time here, please consider hitting the like and subscribe button to get some more content out to you. We got about 60 different interviews, 60 different after parties. I have debates that I've done on here. I have more debates coming up. Open conversation debates, formal debates, the whole works, and I'll be actually moderating some other people's debates too. So thank you guys so much. We air every Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday at 8 p.m. Eastern Time. Thank you guys for everything that you do. Please have a good night.
Don't close yet.
Oh yeah. Randolph, get your stuff out.
Oh yeah. So I am the founding president of an organization called Canadian Atheists. If you want to know more about us, you can find us on the website at canadianatheists.ca. I'll also be co-hosting with Neil, the 604 Atheist, an atheist call-in program called True North Talk, which you can read more about at truenorthtalk.ca. We're just in the midst of renovating the studio to come, so we don't have the call-in program running quite yet, but we're hoping to have that sometime this year.
Awesome.
Thank you for having me on, Justin, and thank you for hosting all of this, and it's very nice to meet all of you.
Absolutely.
Nice to meet you.
Absolutely.
With that being said, you guys have a great night. Thank you for hanging out with us tonight. We will see you Thursday. We are going to have Thomas Bear on for an interview. But until then, you guys stay home, stay safe, and I'll see you on the next episode.
Thanks, Justin.